get up and move. Get up, put your hand to the plow. Get up again and do it again. Yeah, but I lost everything. Get up and do it again. Get up and move. And in your moving, God puts the super on your natural. He can only anoint and work with your movement. The 7, 2 Kings 7, verse 1. Elisha said, "Hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord, tomorrow, about this time, a seer," that's a measurement, "of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel, and 2 seers of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria." Yeah, they are. A donkey's head is really expensive. He says, tomorrow, it's gonna be cheap. Not just donkey's heads, fine flour. That means the wheat has been grown up, it's been harvested, it's been ground, and it's been sifted. Tomorrow. Tomorrow, about this time. I'm speaking to someone tonight. Tomorrow, about this time. Listen, I need a helper. I am tearing out, I'm uprooting, I'm pulling out, I'm getting rid of, I'm plowing doubt and unbelief out of you. Tomorrow, just before you say anything more, keep reading, because there is a message here and you don't want to get caught in it yet. So just smile, act tomorrow, amen, because you'll see in a moment why. I'm saving you. I'm not you. I'm talking about the person that's watching the recording. They needed to see this. He's saying, tomorrow, about this time. Hallelujah. How about that person that needs to be debt free? By this time next week. See, I said, how many want to be debt-free? People, yeah, no, I said, this time next week. No. The man of God said, tomorrow about this time, it's going to be in plenty and it's going to be cheap. Verse 2. So an officer on whose hand the king leaned answered the man of God, said, look, if the Lord could make windows in heaven, could this be? I say, what? This is what I'm protecting you against. The man of God says, tomorrow this time, plenty of goods. Be so much that it's going to be, we'd be giving it away. And the man says, even if God opened the windows, I don't think it's possible. Doubt. Unbelief. So Elisha answers and says, in fact, you will see it with your eyes, but you will not eat of it. What's he saying? Unbelief will stop you from even enjoying as you watch it happening in front of you. Your unbelief will stop you from partaking. Family, when I saw that, I said, forgive me, Lord. Just like Peter said to Jesus, forgive my unbelief. Let it be as according to your word. Hallelujah. So how did this happen? See, we can try and figure out. That's what this officer did. I don't see how that is even possible. So how did it happen? Watch this. Verse 3, there were 4 leprous men at the entrance of the gate. And they said to one another, why are we sitting here until we die? If we say we'll enter the city, the famine's in the city. We're going to die there. If we sit here, we're going to die anyway. So why don't we just go to the army of the Syrians, surrender, and if they kill us, we're about to die anyway. So what are we going to lose? But if they keep us alive, we shall live. So they're saying we at our end anyway. So why not move? I've reached my end. Why not move? Everybody say, move. And they rose at twilight to go to the camp of the Syrians. And when they come to the outskirts of the Syrian camp, to their surprise, no one was there. The camp's empty. How did this happen? The Lord caused the army of the Syrians to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, the noise of a great army. And they said to one another, look, the king of Israel's hired against us, the kings of the Hittites, the kings of the Egyptians, to attack us. So they arose and fled at twilight and left their camp intact, their tents, their horses, and their donkeys, and they fled for lives. You get the picture. There they are sitting, these lepers. They're just talking to one of the four of them. And one guy says, hey, listen, I've got an idea. We stay here, we're dead. The Sumerians, they're eating children. We can die there anyway. Well, why don't we go to the Syrian camp? Okay, let's go. Let's go. And they stir each other up. They decide, well, now you can understand. They're still in the back of their mind. They could be killed. Isn't that right? So they're just walking along. And I don't know how it happened. I'm just like to figure these things out. I try to think myself into the situation. Maybe they were just crossing a little gravel patch. How many of you ever walked in gravel? Your feet and go, what? God said, I can use that. The fact that you're moving, you're making some noise, but I'm going to add my super on your natural. And so you're going, but they are hearing. And everybody, they're like, the Syrians are like, what? There's a whole army coming. Listen. As long as they were moving, they hearing an army coming. God has accentuated. God has amplified. God has taken their movement and created a super of the natural. And the Syrians fled. I mean, they gone. They can't explain it. They didn't even pack their bags. They didn't even get on their horses to ride away. They just ran, man. Whatever they had, they dropped and they were gone. And these four men, they have no idea it even happened. They arrived. Where's everybody? Are they hidden? Where are they? Checking 110. Guys, I don't think there's anyone here. Couldn't be. Everything's still here. Look at all this food. Look at all this food. Look at all this stuff. Where are the people? Gone. Well, let's sit down and have a feast. Man, and they started eating. And then along the way, they like, hang on. We got all this stuff. We don't need to keep it to ourselves. Maybe we go tell the king of Israel. And so they head down to the gates. Hey, king! Can someone talk to the king? Give him a message. What's the message?
The Syrians gone.
Gone. There's no one in the camp. Cannot be. Maybe it's a trick. Maybe they're going to launch an ambush on us. But they eventually send some spies to go and check it out, to go and look at it. And when they got there, you can just imagine they went through the same process, you know, going through with a clear, 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 get through the whole camp. The guys are gone. There's all the stuff. Now, it's not written there. I am just of the opinion. So if you like it, celebrate it. But if you don't, we'll stay friends. Those lepers went right up to that city. You were not allowed to be in public as a leper. I personally believe as they went, they were healed. That's in my spirit. How else are you going to get close enough to say? See, when God does something, He doesn't leave any. He's not going to. Why would He feed them and leave them lepers? There is a blessing when you obey God. There is blessing in the movement. That's exactly what. Okay, you want a scripture that I can say I'm referring to? This one is in the Word. There were 12 lepers. Isn't that right? 10 lepers. Let's get those numbers right. 10 lepers. And they called out to Jesus. And He said, go show yourself to the priest. He didn't say be healed. He said, go show yourself to the priest. Well, what's that about? Well, under the law, the priest had to evaluate you. He looked at your scars and whatever, and he determined that person had leprosy. Then he would mark them, give them a garment, and from that day on, they were not allowed to be anywhere near anyone. And wherever they went, they had to call unclean, unclean, which gave you the opportunity to walk on the other side to stay away from them. When you believe a miracle happened to you, if you believe you've been healed, then the process was, if all of a sudden the person woke up and they saw all the scabs are gone and they're not sick anymore, they had the right to go to the priest for him to reevaluate. And he would reevaluate you and then, on that evaluation, declare you clean. So Jesus bypasses time. Go show yourself to the priest. He's not even saying, be healed. What's he saying? You are healed. Why do you still think you're a leper? I'm saying you are in a state where you can go show yourself to the priest. And they say, oh, well, if he says so, let's walk. And as they walking, as they are moving, they look and go, what? And the one goes running back to Jesus and falls at his knees and worships him. Where are the other nine? I'm here. He says, your faith has made you whole. He got his nose back. He got his ear back. He got everything that had fallen off. He got back. Come on, give Jesus praise. And so, next moment, the whole of Samaria arrives at the camp, and people are rushing in to go and get all the stuff, all these goods. And come down and have a look. 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 16. The people went out and plundered the tents of the Syrians. So a seah of fine flour was sold for a shekel. And 2 seahs of barley for a shekel, according to the word of the Lord. Now come down to verse 19. That officer
that had answered the man of God and said, now look, if the Lord would make heavens in windows in heaven, could such a thing be? And the man of God said, in fact, you will see it with your eyes, but you'll not eat it. It happened to him, for the people trampled him in the gate, and he died. Family, unbelief will stop us. We can actually, a person can see what's happening, but never get to partake of it. For this man, it was final. Don't turn off the belief. Expect the supernatural. When a man of God decrees something, lock into it. When God has given a promise, don't try and figure out how it's going to happen. It doesn't make sense. How is it even possible? When you know the state we're in, how can we from here, 24 hours, get to an abundance where things are so cheap? I don't see how that's possible. And yet, God did it. God has a way to do it. And here's the thing. Don't try to figure out how. When that officer doubted Elisha, he didn't say, you know what? I think there's going to be four lepers. And no, God moved. The word worked. The man had spoken. And things were kicked into action. But you notice how when the word came upon those lepers, they made a decision to move. Family of God, I'm saying today, I don't know what your movement is, but don't be afraid of walking straight at the enemy's camp. When the devil's staring you down and he's threatening you and he's saying, who are you? Do you think I am a dog that you come to me with sticks and stones? David said, I don't come to you as a man. I come to you with the name of God. And he ran at his giant. In the movement, he saw the supernatural. Don't be afraid of the enemy. Don't let him shout you down. Don't let him talk you out of your miracle. Get up. I know what it's like. I do know what it's like. I have been there when it seems like everything is depressing you. Everything's against you. Everything's trying to hurt you and pull you down. And it's so easy to get smashed so often that you're buckling at the knees. And you don't know how you're ever going to get out of this. Is there any way out of this? And I'm yet to tell you, tomorrow, about this time. Tomorrow, about this time. I just don't even feel like getting up to go to work. Get up and move. Get up, put your hand to the plow. Get up again and do it again. Yeah, but I lost everything. Get up and do it again. Get up and move. And in your moving, God puts the super on your natural. He can only anoint and work with your movement. Don't let the enemy intimidate you. Never, never, never give up. I don't care if somebody's lost everything. Watch God turn it around. You see, in the natural, I've sat with a man in tears, a fully grown, strong man in tears because of something his partner did. And when I spoke to him about the word, he says, you don't understand. It took me years to get to where I am. I understand that. But God has a way of tomorrow, this time.
Don't think how you got there previously in the natural. You are now in the supernatural. And tomorrow about this time. How many are ready for some tomorrows about this time? Come on, stand to your feet and give Jesus his praise. Come on, give him glory. Give him glory. You see, some of us are shouting a little louder because you don't understand. We're at the donkey head situation, but I'm not going to let that stop me, because I know my God, and I know his word, and I know his power, and I believe him. Yeah, but I don't believe. That doesn't matter. Your unbelief's not stopping me.
Because there are people here that believe. And there are those that are walking towards the enemy's camp, knowing it's already empty. See, the enemy's just smoke and mirrors. He's just noise, man. He just tries to cause things to put us off. Hallelujah. And I don't mean that to criticize. It just means the pressure's got too much. The lack, the worries, the concerns, that I'm going to lose this. I'm going to lose my job. What happens if I don't get a bit? And I can't pay this bill. I can't pay that. What happens? It's the stripping away of the inner man, that emptying out where fear begins to take over. How do you solve that? The perfect love of God flushes out fear. You begin to feed on the Word. You begin to spend time in the Word. You begin to spend time meditating on God's Word. You receive and you ingest His presence. You spend time worshiping Him. When we're starting to lose, feel like we're on the edge and we're frayed and we're getting more angry, easier, it's because we haven't been in the presence. Because when I'm filled with the presence of God, nothing affects me because of His presence. Hallelujah. We stay here, we're going to die. We go over there, we're going to die. The enemy might kill us, we're going to die anyway. But here's what I'm going to do. I'm getting up and I'm moving forward. And in that moving, the super comes on your natural. Just lift your hand. Say, Father, I receive your living word. Today, I am filled with your presence. I receive the love of God. I receive the filling of God. I receive your anointing. I receive your grace. I receive your life. I receive your joy. Your power floods and fills me. And I believe you are supernatural. I believe the supernatural life of God flows through me. When I move in the name of Jesus, I see the super on my natural. I do everything I know to do, but God, you amplify it, you accelerate it, and tomorrow about this time, you shouted, I have my victory, I have my breakthrough, I have.
For many, the supernatural is generally associated with spooky or scary or the unexplained.
When you watch Jesus and he was on the earth, everywhere he went, miracles were happening all the time on a continual basis.
In this series, Allan Bagg delves into what the supernatural is.
Family, we serve a supernatural God. You are not limited to the natural world. You are not bound by natural laws.
He helps shed light on what this means to a believer and how you can live a supernatural life.
You trust Jesus. Trust His name. You serve a supernatural God. You live in a supernatural world. And by His power and His name, you govern the natural world.
Get this series online at allanbagministries.org and step into living the supernatural life.
Friend, if you've never yet given your life to Jesus, I want you to know He loves you. He died for you. The most supernatural thing that took place was Jesus' death on that cross. Because in His death, He crushed sin forever, destroyed it. And He said, whoever believes in Him will not perish but have everlasting life. The moment you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the influence of sin, the destruction of sin, the result of sin, sins itself is forgiven. Everything you've ever done, forgiven and cleansed, and you are made a new creature in Christ, born again. I want to lead you in that prayer tonight, and I won't embarrass you. We're all going to pray out the same prayer out loud. But if you say, that's me, I want to give my life to Jesus tonight. I want to be born again. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, wherever you're standing, raise up your hand. Maybe you prayed a prayer like this before, but right now you know your life's not right with God. Somehow you're backslid, but today you're coming home. You want to rededicate your life. Lift your hand as well. We're all going to pray out loud now. I'm going to ask everyone, please pray with me, but especially if you raise your hand, say this: dear Jesus, thank you. You died for me. You gave your life for me. And then you rose from the dead. Today, you're alive. I believe it. I call you my Lord. You are my Savior. From this day on, I live for you to serve and worship you. One day, I will leave this earth and stand before you and see you face to face. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God, my friend. You're born again, a child of God now.
Well, congratulations to all of those that just gave their life to the Lord. If that was you, we would like to get a free pack to you. That pack will help you build your faith and help you in your walk with God today. So what you can do is you can make your way to our website. You can fill in your name and your details, and we'll get this pack to you as soon as possible. Well, family, if you enjoyed this message, it's part of a whole series called Living the Supernatural Life. And if you want to learn how to live a supernatural life in a natural world with a supernatural God, you can make your way to our website and you can get this series for yourself, and you can learn how to live a supernatural life. Well, family, this has been Wisdom for Life. Thank you for taking the time to watch with us. My name is Joshua Bagg, and remember, Jesus is Lord, and life is a choice. Choose life.